Olympic champion and four-time world champion Scotty Hamilton gone from amateur competition. The race for the gold has become even closer. From Canada comes Olympic silver medalist Brian Urser, always second to Hamilton, but with the best free skating program in the world and the heir apparent to the gold here in Tokyo. Urser will not turn to gold without withstanding the challenge of this man, Soviet Alexander Fadeev. Fadeev's arsenal of jumping and technical footwork will keep him close to perfect sixes. For the United States, young Brian Boitano knows full well he'll have to pull out all the stops for a chance to step onto the podium. And over everyone's shoulder, Josef Sobavchuk, who has hit quadruple jumps in practice. If he hits in competition, it will be the first ever, and it may well win him the gold. It's all coming up on the World Figure Skating Championships.
I'm Tim Ryan, and...
Sports presents the World Figure Skating Championships. The very best on ice will wear the gold. Today in the men's final, you'll see Olympic silver medalist and last year's silver medalist here, Canada's Brian Urser, chasing the number one spot that has always eluded him. With Scott Hamilton gone, Urser has been picked as the heir apparent, and his free skating last year was the judge's choice for number one. But this year, there's another obstacle whirling in the Canadian's path. Soviet Alexander Fadeev, whose skates rarely touch the ice, and when they do, it's only in preparation for more athletic magic. Fadeev and Urser on a collision course in the final round of a battle that will be decided only after all blades have scratched the ice. The United States hopes rest on the shoulders of national champion Brian Boitano, and Boitano knows he will have to skate the performance of his lifetime as he takes aim at precious metal. Also today, we bring you coverage of the Paris competition, and the story here, who can possibly beat the Soviet husband-wife team of Valava and Vasilya, the defending champions who have lifted themselves high above all rivals. We are in Yoyogi Arena, site of the swimming and diving competition at the 64 Games. It's home today for the action in the World Figure Skating Championships. Hello everyone, I'm John Tesh, and it's our pleasure here at CBS to bring you our coverage of the most important figure skating event of the year, the World Championships. And all of the world's best are here to compete in the four disciplines, ice dancing, pairs, ladies, and men's skating. And right now we're getting set for the finals of the men's competition. And you know, since four-time world champion and Olympic champion American Scott Hamilton has retired from the sport, that's made the competition among the other top skaters that much closer. Well, Scotty's now our expert commentator for figure skating. And Scott, earlier today when we took a look at the men in their final practices at the other arena, it looked like the competition had already begun in earnest.
It's really exciting. The men now see an opportunity to win a world championship now that I'm gone, excuse me, and they're going for it all the way. I've never seen such technical brilliance in a group of men so closely knit together in competition. And the routines are more difficult this year. And what's really exciting is I think we could see the first quadruple jump ever landed in world competition.
In fact, earlier this week at one of the training facilities here in Tokyo, our cameras were there when young Czechoslovakian skater Josef Sobavchuk did successfully complete a quadruple jump. One, two, three, four revolutions, and so Sobavchuk successfully completed it. And then after practice, he told us that he would in fact be using it in the competition. And as you take a look at the leaderboard, he may well need it, because Sobavchuk is in second place behind Alexander Fadeev, the Soviet, and Brian Urser is in third place. Now, you've been up top there entering the long program. What's that about?
Well, being in first place going into the long program is where you want to be. You work all year to be on the top, and if you want to end up first, you want to be there. Alexander Fadeev, this is the first time he's been there, and it's going to be an education for him. He's got Brian Urser right behind him, and usually you could be conservative in this position, but I know Alexander Fadeev. I've traveled with him, I've competed against him, I toured with him, and conservative isn't in his vocabulary, and Brian Urser is right behind him, and he won't be allowed to be conservative. So it's going to be an exciting competition.
Well, Fadeev, the Soviet, will be the first to skate in the free skating. Take a look at the ice here. It's rather unusual to see streaks like this. What happened was they froze the ice too quickly, and they ended up with those lines through it. Some of the skaters complained about it. Brian Urser, picked as the favorite coming in here. Well, the first to skate, Alexander Fadeev. We'll be back with his performance in a moment.
You got 14, you got one. No.
Soviet.
The man who was in first place entering this, the long program, which counts 50%, 21-year-old Alexander Fadeev, Soviet Union.
And he has has an amazingly difficult program in store for us tonight. He's going to open up with a triple lutz jump.
Remember, Fadeev is in first place. He told me after the final practice earlier this afternoon that he would, in fact...
Triple axel double toe! He is really going all out!
He told me he would, in fact, attempt a quadruple, even though he didn't need to do it, to stay in the lead. He said it was important to him. Competition, and so far it looks like they made the right decision.
He is skating so well.
Alexander Fadeev, who was a junior champion back in 1980, and he has been headed upwards ever since. Exhausted. Let's take a look at the replay now of that first jump.
This is his opening move. It's a triple Lutz jump. Look how high he goes. A little behind, and he has enough speed and control to throw a triple toe loop. That's one of the hardest combinations I've ever seen in competition.
Alexander Fadeev wait now for his first. The first set of scores is on the board.
Just straight sixes across the board, technically.
You can hear the Soviet fans clapping as they announce each one of the scores. Upcoming will be the scores, the second set of scores for artistic impression. And we'll see if those are as good as the ones for technical merit.
Well, he's so great technically. I wonder if the second mark will stay the same or go down. There's not a whole lot of room for the rest of the skaters.
Marks for artistic impression, not as good, but the low is 5-7, one from the French and one from the Japanese judge. So Alexander Fadeev sets an impossible standard to beat. Next to skate is this man backstage getting a kiss from his coach, Josef Sabavchik. Get that lipstick off, Josef. Can't skate with that. We'll be back. We'll be the second to skate here in the men's final at the World Figure Skating Championships. A little excitement in the warm-up. Josef hit his quadruple jump, Scotty.
Nobody's ever done this move in world-level competition, and it could happen tonight. He hits one in warm-up, he could just do it.
Now the Olympic bronze medalist, fourth year last year, 21-year-old Josef Sabavchik from Czechoslovakia. All the talk here has been about the quad. Performance could leave the door open for American Brian Boitano to win his first world champion medal. We'll be skating later.
Falcao turned into a single. That's a serious turn. When you go and you put so much on a quadruple toe loop, you know, going into a program and you miss it, it seems to take the importance off the rest of the program. And he looks a little bit deflated emotionally and physically. A triple toe loop and he doubled it. I'm sure he's disappointed.
One-year-old Josef Sabavcik from Czechoslovakia, who told us his only real chance to beat Fadeev for a gold medal was to hit his quadruple jump, and he pulled out in the middle.
This is a jump that set up the rest of the program. He does a triple axel here. Notice how high he gets up in the air. There's one, two, three, and he over-rotates it and comes down really low.
His marks are coming, and for technical merit, they reflect his problems. Low of 5'3", there are one, two, three of those. The high of 5'6" comes from the Japanese judge for artistic impression now, and a little better, but still not enough to go after the Soviet Fadeev.
Well, he only landed two triple jumps the whole routine, and that reflects in his technical merit mark. Let's take a look at the quadruple attempt. Watch his left shoulder. He rushes the jump, he pulls it up, and he's no longer able to pull the four turns out of the jump, and he had to bail out.
What's important to remember here is, after Sabavcik's marks, the American, Brian Boitano, has a chance to move up. He was fifth entering the pre-skating program. He's still escaped. Let's go down to John Misha Petkovic, who's with Josef now.
Josef, hello. What happened? What went
I don't know. I was just probably too much concentrating on a quad.
Are you disappointed that didn't come off?
Yeah.
And that ruined the rest of the program for you?
I was kind of like, I missed a quad, and I said, like, now I have to do everything. And everything came out like I was rushing and putting too much power in it. That's why it came out like doubles.
Brian Boitano skates next for a chance at a medal. The American, Brian Boitano, 21 years old. Fifth at the Olympics, sixth at the World Championships last year, with a chance here for a medal. Fourth, entering a long program.
He's going to open with his most difficult move, a triple axel. Something that will not be done the rest of the competition. A three jump combination, two of the jumps being triples. Double flip, triple toe, triple toe. Double flip, triple toe, double toe. He didn't have enough speed to pull the triple.
His first national championship this year after seven tries.
Beautiful triple X. He's about the last guy in the world you want behind you because he's so consistent, you know he's not going to miss.
skating beautifully and skating with a chance here after Josip Sobotchik's performance for his first world championship medal.
Wow, he is really on. Triple flip, double toe loop combination.
Somebody say something about no depth after Scott Hamilton.
Why do you think I'm sitting here?
His coach said that the action by the crowd wasn't good enough, so he went back to the program he had earlier.
Well, as you can see, everybody's really into this ending, so I think it was a good choice. Notice the height and the tightness of rotation. One, two, three, up, clean. 1 foot landing, beautiful jump.
They're coming scores now, and they're very good. 2 5-8s, one from the French and one from the Finnish judge, but the rest are 5 7s, so technical merit is quite good.
Excellent, he's a great technical skater.
Artistic impression up now, and those are even better. 1 2 3 4 5 8s, lowest scores are 5 7s.
Those are great marks, and they could be good enough to get him a bronze medal.
There's Tiffany Chin in attendance, another American figure skater who has a chance at a medal here. Here's John Misha with Brian.
Brian, I have to tell you, that was a very fine performance.
Thank you. I was really pleased. I've had a tough week, and I just wanted to go out and skate a really good program, and I'm so happy with it.
Well, next to skate will be the Canadian national champion, Brian Orser, pacing backstage. We'll be back with his performance. The Olympic silver medalist behind Scott Hamilton, Canadian Brian Orser, 23 years old, who was third entering the long program. A lot of people thought that he was a sure bet for the gold. But along came Alexander Fadeev, along came Josip Sobotchik, and it's been a fight.
He's had a rough time here, but this is his event. This is what he won at the World Championships last year and the Olympic Games. And it's technically as difficult as Alexander Fadeev's. Jump. Oh, and he hangs on. Nice jump. Arser, now he's the sexy Brian Arser. That's great. Shows some versatility. Supposed to be triple side double loop, but the double loop was a single loop.
Watching Canadian Brian Arser, really in his perennial pursuit for a gold medal, which has eluded him for so long. First, you were standing in his way, and now Fadeev. As I mentioned, a lot of people thought that he was a sure bet.
Situation when you've never really won the medal to wear it around your neck for a year and then come here with the pressure of repeating.
You know, Scotty, watching Brian Arser in this year's Worlds in Tokyo and comparing the performance to last year's in Canada, he doesn't seem to have the spark here.
Yeah, he doesn't seem to be performing at his best emotionally tonight. The spark, the electricity around his performance isn't there.
Remember, the judges are reacting to not only what they see, but what they feel.
Going to try something that really hasn't been done. He's going to try to repeat a triple Lutz jump. No, it's a double. You can see the men around this point in their long program, they start to get a little fatigued. Their shoulders come up a little bit and their arms sag, and their jumps seem to be a little bit looser in the air. But right here, it starts to tilt backwards, right there. See how tilted it is? It takes a lot of strength to be able to pull this out on a running edge. Ah, see? Great effort.
So now Arser waiting for his scores. And that's got to be brutal, all that waiting.
You know, you work all year for this event, and then it's over, and maybe things could have gone better. It's just a real helpless feeling.
So all in the hands of the judges now. The first set of scores, again, will be from nine judges from nine different countries. First scores will be for technical merit. To the highs, but look at this, the Canadian and the United States judge, Scotty, both gave Arser 5-6.
And 5-6 is below both Boitano and Fadeev.
So Arser, based on these scores, really with no chance to catch Alexander Fadeev, who is in first place at this point, will still wait for the artistic impression scores. But what's interesting here, Scotty, is the low 5-6 that was given by the Canadian judge.
There's like nowhere near the marks he got last year.
Here they come, artistic impression. These scores are much better. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9. The high score of 5-9 was not given by the Canadian judge. He gave a 5-7, so Brian Arser will not catch the Soviet Alexander Fadeev. Fadeev is assured the gold medal, but silver and bronze are still up for grabs. Right now, let's go down to John Misha Petrovich, who's with Brian Arser.
Well, what do you think, Brian? Is that a silver medal performance?
I guess we'll see soon when the final results come out.
I noticed that on a number of those jumps, in spite of the fact that it was a very excellent program, it was as though you just pulled them out at the last minute.
I was a little extra nervous tonight. And the ice was a little harder than I'm used to. So, I'm pleased with the way it went.
Well, I thought it was very good. Congratulations, and let's look and see if that silver's around the corner.
Okay, thank you.
Good luck.
Well, it's all up to the computer now. We'll sort things out. We'll be back with the results of the men's program in the World Championships in a moment. Gold medalist here in the men's competition at the World Figure Skating Championships. And it is Alexander Fadeev from the Soviet Union, first in the compulsory, first in the short program, and he won the free skating program. Silver medalist now skating out onto the ice. The Canadian Brian Orser thwarted again in his bid for a gold medal, but he'll stand silver once again. We have a surprise for you for the bronze, and he'll be announced to the crowd in just a few moments here. Brian Boitano slips in ahead. Czechoslovakian Josef Sobavček, and Boitano wins his first world championship medal. Look at how happy Boitano is. The final standings again, Fadeev, Orser, and the American Boitano.
So the story in the men's competition, the surprise bronze medal for the American Brian Boitano, his first world championship medal. Now last night, the Paris competition was held, and there were no medals for the Americans. But there was some hope for the future.
Number 8, Jill Watson and Peter Oppegaard, USA.
Americans Jill Watson and Peter Oppegaard trying to fill the void in American Paris skating, left by the retirement of Kitty and Peter Carruthers. Watson and Oppegaard were sixth after their short program. Entering this, they're free skating. At 6 feet, Peter is a full foot taller than Jill. But the truly amazing thing about this pair is that they've only been skating together since this summer. Peter has had two previous partners. Jill also switched partners after her partner, Bert Lansone, turned professional. It was last year at the Worlds when Watson and Lansone suffered an awful crash in their short program. The two eventually had to pull out of the competition, and Peter Oppegaard would later say he was inspired with the way Jill Watson was able to get up and complete this short program. But the two were out of the competition. So this year, both Watson and Peter Oppegaard with a new future in pair skating. They had their minor problems in the free skating final. Nonetheless, it was a fine performance. When the marks came up and the skating was over, Watson and Oppegaard had taken fourth place. But the pair to beat this year was the Soviet team of Elena Volova and Oleg Vasilyev, who arrived here in Tokyo with a uniquely choreographed program to carry on a great tradition in Soviet pair skating. Wintertime in Leningrad, Russia's imperial city, where the Tsars spend their summers. And today, where children use their sleds in a park once owned by the Tsar. Today, what appears before the watchful eyes of Vladimir Lenin? Endless lines of Soviets queue up for, of all things, ice cream in winter. And their choice for winter sports? There are other winter sports in Leningrad. They start them young here. Those who show potential in the Soviet sports schools are on ice skates soon after they learn to walk. The recent products of this program, Olympic champions Elena Belova and Oleg Vasilyev, under the tutelage of their coach Tamara Moskvina. Following the Olympic gold medal, the pair were joined in marriage. But then, they were upset at the World Championships in Ottawa. They had won the gold in 1983. When they came back to defend, it was lost to Canadians Underhill and Martini. They come to this year.
Warriors World's hungry to repeat their 1983 world title. After all, they are part of a tradition that includes the legendary Protopopovs, four-time world champions. And Rodnina and Zaitsev, six-time world champions who took a gold right here in Tokyo. They embody the concept of Soviet pair skating, which has now been inherited by Volova and Vasiliev.
It seems to me that people in our country are more used to such work in big or small groups to work together.
As husband and wife, the two skaters' time off the ice is still timed together. If they weren't chattering away in Russian, you'd think you were watching a battle in Space Invaders between two American kids. But not much of their lives is spent without speaking or hearing some sort of skating vocabulary. Working here with their choreographer. But the question to the married champions, what of children?
Я сразу же, как только закончу, как только так сразу заведу.
А ты у меня спросил?
Я тебе не спрошу.
Well, if there is to be time for a family, you get the feeling the decision might well be shared by Coach Moskvina. Uses, but who certainly needs no microphone to bark instructions to her students.
At the beginning, I see their weak point, I start to develop them, and I want these people to be very strong characters. So I can make the character grow in this person and grow as high as the world Olympic champions.
So as Volova and Vasiliev began this year's pairs free skating program here in Tokyo, it wasn't without a large piece of Soviet skating history on their shoulders. The routine was inspiring, skated to the music of the Soviet ballet Shurali. It's the story of a forest devil who sees a beautiful bird in the forest and thinks that by possessing her, he too can become beautiful. It was a world championship goal the two Soviets dearly wanted. The story and the skating touched the judges. Appeared, there was no one even close. Volova and Vasiliev, with their coach Tamara Moskvina, had again regained the gold medal as a pair and now as husband and wife. Standing in gold medal position and in silver, the two Soviets, as you take a look at the final standings in the pair skating.
Thank you.
I'm John Tesh for John Misha Petkovic and Scotty Hansen, saying so long for now. Prowess